Thank you, members. The final item of business is a members' business debate on motion 2745 in the name of Maurice Golden on tackling dog theft. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Maurice Golden to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank members from across the chamber for supporting this motion. Dog theft is a serious and growing problem. Almost 200 dogs are estimated to have been stolen in 2020, and almost 2,500 across the UK as a whole. That works out in nearly 7 dogs stolen each and every day. And the problem has got worse during the pandemic. The charity Dog Lost recorded an alarming 170% increase in cases. That should not be entirely unexpected, though. The loneliness many felt during the long months of lockdown saw an increased demand for dogs as pets. And we know dogs are the most likely animal to be stolen. Figures from the Metropolitan Police show that an astonishing 7 out of 10 stolen animals are dogs. And with the price of certain breeds having jumped up as much as 89% over lockdown, dog theft can be a very lucrative crime. However, it is important to recognise that the data on dog theft is woefully incomplete. We don't know exactly how many incidents take place, where the theft hotspots are, or how certain breeds might be targeted. The existing law treats stealing a dog as any other property theft. So there is no requirement for the police to record that a dog was involved, let alone additional information such as breed type. And this brings us to the simple, sad fact. The law of the land treats dogs as nothing more than things. As far as the law is concerned, stealing a dog is no different to stealing a mobile phone, a TV, or any other inanimate object. But dogs are not objects. They are part of the family. And for many people, their dogs are by far the most important part of their lives. The current law simply does not recognise this treasured and irreplaceable role that they have. That means justice is very rarely served. Because the law treats dogs as mere property, a dog's monetary value will influence sentencing. But the Kennel Club estimates many older dogs that are stolen are worth well under £500, and thus potentially attracting lighter punishments. So it is unsurprising there is little evidence of maximum sentences being handed out. But sentencing only matters if there are convictions. Sadly, across the UK, where suspects are identified, just 5% of cases see someone charged. And in total, just 1% of dog thefts actually lead to prosecutions. That's not justice. Given these problems, it is understandable the focus until now has been on prevention, and both Police Scotland and animal welfare bodies are working hard to help educate and support dog owners to avoid thefts. Microchipping helps too. All dogs over 8 weeks must be chipped and registered. But this only goes so far. There are multiple competing microchip databases that make access cumbersome, and records are not always properly updated, so reuniting dogs and owners can be difficult. So with dogs and owners lacking proper protection, I am introducing a members' bill to help tackle this growing problem. My bill will create a specific offence of dog theft, basing punishment on the welfare impact to the animal and owner, not just on the dog's monetary value. It will provide data recording so we can build an accurate picture of dog theft in Scotland and help prevent future thefts. My bill will also ensure Scotland is not left behind internationally on animal welfare. France, parts of Australia and New Zealand already have specific offences, and England and Ireland are planning to introduce legislation soon. In addition, the equally poor data situation in England will be addressed with standardised crime recording across police forces, more robust rules for registering ownership and transfer data, and, in a very welcome move, creating a single point of access for the multitude of microchip databases. This is a huge step forward that we should be racing to take advantage of here in Scotland. In Scotland, there is strong support for taking action. Welfare groups have come out publicly in support of my bill, such as Dogs Trust, the Scottish SPCA, the Kennel Club, Blue Cross and the Edinburgh Dog and Cat Home. I am grateful for their support and for the support we see today across Parliament. Almost every party backed today's motion on tackling dog theft, and I'm happy to sit down with the Greens, although I appreciate they're not in the chamber today, to find a way for them to offer their support in the future, because this Parliament is at its best when it acts as one. And we should be as one when it comes to animal welfare, a cause I am passionate about. That is why I am determined Scotland should lead on this, with the specific offence of dog theft that recognises the welfare impact this crime has on both animal and owner. That improves data recording to help prevent future thefts and hopefully allows more stolen dogs to be reunited with their owners. If that famous old phrase that dogs are our best friend is true, then we must repay that friendship and give our beloved companions the full protection of the law.
Thank you. I now call on Christine Graham to be followed by Jamie Green. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank Maurice Goldman for bringing this debate, which I welcome. And acknowledge that theft of dogs is on the rise, though we know the actual figures for reasons he's given are not available, and I'll come to that later. Sometimes guilt and heartbreak certainly ensues when you have a much-loved pet stolen. You won't know what's happened to the dog, its future, and how it has reacted to being removed from its home. All of these I appreciate. And in my day, when my family had the companionship and affection of Roosty, our much-loved member of the family, Irish Setter, thankfully, when she went missing, she simply wandered off and soon found her usually on the river bank at the bottom of the garden, or she trotted home herself. I know if she had been stolen, we would have been distraught. And even then, dog theft was virtually unknown, and we're in a different world, with the demand outstripping supply and the high value in monetary terms put on dogs. That is where I start. We also know now are much more informed about all animals as sentient beings, although as pet owners, we've always known that certainly of our dogs, their individuality and personalities, they are indeed one of the family. But now to the detail, where the devil always lies. I know that Roddy Dunlop, Dean of the Faculty of Advocates, a dog owner himself, while appreciating the motivations behind the bill, the proposal for the member, considers that the offence is already covered by the common law on theft. And indeed, the well-meaning, a separate offence, presumably with a maximum of 5 years, reduces the existing available sentencing range. The view from him is that if sentences are not currently suitable, then the independent Scottish Sentencing Council, tasked with setting sentencing guidelines and taking into account other issues the member has raised and consistency across the court, has that role. I'm not supporting it, I'm just raising it. I'm just raising these matters. The motion, certainly yes.
Maurice Goldman.
I thank the member for taking an intervention. Just to clarify on the sentencing guidelines, I will be consulting on the length of term through discussing with the dog charities. We think that 5 years is reasonable and proportionate, and in fact, from the evidence that we've looked at, no one is receiving beyond that in the current system, but it is an opportunity to extend it if so wished.
Indeed, because there is a role for the Scottish Sentencing Council. The motion also refers to the impact on owners, which it infers should have an impact on sentences. However, the existing victim impact statements, to the best of my knowledge, do not usually alter the weight of evidence nor the value of any reports commissioned by the court, nor usually the sentence, unless, and it's unusual, they may in the case of a matter of serious crime, for example, rape. To give an example, a burglary in an empty domestic property may have different impacts on different people, even though the events are identical. The burglar sneaks through an unlocked door, lifts the computer and leaves. One householder is upset but angry at having left the door unlocked. The other now feels totally insecure in their home and violated by someone uninvited being there. It would be difficult to argue that all things being equal, as I've expressed, other than the impact on the householder, the penalties should be different. What is without contention is that data and dog thefts reported, prosecuted, then with outcomes, should be collected. That is an important move forward and should be changed. Accepting, as I do, that animals are sentient beings and not things is another complication. Can we really argue that the theft of a dog should be equated to abducting a child? I don't have answers to these questions, but these have to be addressed. Legislation, as we all know, is tricky stuff, and I've just touched on some of the difficulties. But can I reassure the member, I do support his proposal. I will see his bill as it's laid and hope that it functions properly. But we all know these issues have to be addressed to make legislation that is sound and functional. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Jamie Green to be followed by Colin Smith. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's been a year, almost to the day, since I adopted my dog, Astro. He's a rescue dog from Romania. Yes, I've heard the joke that he has a European passport and I don't many times. But I went almost 40 years in life without him, and I now can't imagine my life without him at all. And I know he's watching this debate online. From home, so, as we so often say in members' debates. The wildlife photographer Roger Karas once said, "Dogs are not our whole life, but they make our lives whole." Well, I disagree. I think dogs are your whole life, and anyone that's got a dog will know that. The Dogs Trust, in its briefing, told us that having a dog improves your well-being and reduces stress. They've clearly never met my dog. But right now in Scotland, if you were to look at the legislative environment that surrounds dog safety and security, I don't think you would necessarily believe that we are a nation of dog lovers, which is the point of today's debate. The theft of a dog has been relentlessly highlighted by my colleague, Maurice Golden, not just in weeks and months, but over years now, because it is the same as having your phone or your wallet stolen or your watch. Dog theft is widespread now. There's been a 170% increase over the pandemic, according to some. And that's hardly surprising, given the price of some breeds has more than doubled. In fact, when I was looking for a dog, I went for a rescue charity, mostly out of a sense of frustration at the prices being sought by many breeders, but also the unscrupulous nature by which some of them are being sold and bred. Because my dog is not a gold watch. Its value is not in its value, in its breed. I felt much better giving my money to a charity and rescuing a pup which otherwise would have been on the street. And on that note, can I pay huge credit to the charity Paws to Rescue, in one of the great charities that do work in this space, and publicly thank Ricky Gervais, who is their patron. In the area that I represent, there's been some really high profile reports of dog thefts and the effect that has on the victims. At a breeding farm in Golson, there was the loss of four puppies, and we all read the tragic case of the young couple who had their dog stolen from their garden in Kilburnie. My heart really goes out to them. I can't imagine what it would feel like. I once had an episode where he ran out at the front door when I was taking the bins out, straight into the in front of oncoming traffic, and my heart literally stopped for about 8 seconds. And you think, for that instance, how would I feel if I lost my dog? I cannot imagine what it would feel like knowing that someone has come into your home or your garden and taken them away. I don't think our justice system adequately serves as a deterrent for dog theft, because 5% of dog thefts result in someone being charged and just 1% lead to prosecution. If that was any other field, we would be in absolute uproar. I shouldn't forget cats, by the way. I've got nothing against cats. So any legislation could look at pets. In the round. I think we should take steps to deter those who steal our furry friends. It's a massive business. In fact, we know that the third most profitable illegal trade after narcotics and weapons are pets. And serious organised criminal gangs and syndicates have given up trading drugs, actually, because of the risk involved, and they've switched to illegal dog trading. They've gone from cocaine and meth labs to canines and pet labs. That's the sad reality of where we are at. To its credit, the Scottish Government did introduce microchipping back in 2016. That was absolutely the right thing to do. And Christine Graham, amongst others, and other dog and pet lovers have spoken to legislate further in these areas, as have the Dogs Trust, who I pay a huge amount of commendable work to. Their political asks, see what I did there, are very worthy campaigns, many of which I support and should be looked on favourably. We can do more, we must do more. All I would ask of the Government, if it's not able to support the Dog Theft Bill specifically, then what else can we do to either change sentencing guidelines or take into account the emotional effect that this very specific type of theft has on the people that those animals are taken from? I have confidence that all these unanswered questions can be answered. I know we can do it, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Excuse me. I now call Colin Smith to be followed by Kenneth Gibson. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Maurice Golden both for tabling his motion for debate, but also for raising, I think, the really important issue of whether we do need a new criminal offence for dog theft. As we've heard, pet theft is not currently treated with the seriousness it deserves in our society. Legally, stealing a dog is pretty much treated the same way as stealing someone's phone, and that simply can't be right. Well, we live in a society where, sadly, maybe we are a bit too attached to our phones. They can easily be replaced like for like, but you cannot replace a unique, loved family pet, the loss of which can be really devastating for families. And at present, the law doesn't adequately consider the emotional distress caused by the loss of a pet. Pets are companions, they're part of our families, and the law should better acknowledge that. As Christine Graham's highlighted, animals are also sentient beings. We all know that. The science has proved that they experience pain, suffering, joy and comfort, but by equating them to property, we are denying them the right to be considered sentient beings, and that's simply not right. And, Presiding Officer, now certainly seems to be the time to reassess the law so we don't continue to brutally regard pets largely as property. The past few years have been really challenging for everyone. During that time, for many people, their pets have provided company and support through periods of isolation and constant worry. More and more people have turned to pets to provide that comfort at times of huge uncertainty. And more than ever, we understand, we better appreciate the huge benefits a pet can bring to a household. Over the half that the people surveyed by Blue Cross said their first pet taught them unconditional love or the meaning of friendship. They and other charities have seen from the fantastic work they do to rehome pets that they improve owners' mental and physical health, they prevent loneliness and they encourage learning and empathy in children. So let's recognise this, let's properly value the welfare and safety of our animals. Well, today's motion focuses on the theft of dogs, and I understand why. We've seen a big rise in dog theft during the pandemic, up by, I think, around 170%, partly because the price paid for dogs has risen by as much as, I think, Maurice Golden said, 89%. Although, of course, the monetary value of a loved pet is what owners care about the least. But it is important that we protect, under robust animal welfare laws, all of our animals, whatever the monetary value, a point that's been made by Cat Protection. It may be less reported, but cat theft in the UK increased by 194% between 2015 and 2020, and that crime will impact on a family just as much as the theft of a dog. We also know that in Scotland, well, all dogs over 8 weeks must be microchipped. That isn't the case for cats, making it much more difficult to return stolen or lost cats to their owners. So if we are to strengthen the law on dog theft, or even look at strengthening sentencing guidance to better cover pet theft, which is a point that's been raised. Yeah, I certainly will.
Christine Graham.
One of the horrors I know the member is aware of about microchipping is that these criminals, in fact, will remove the microchip from the animals that they steal in sometimes dreadful ways.
Colin Smith.
I think it's a very important point Christine Graham highlights, and I think that's why really taken pet theft seriously is so important, because some of these criminals really, frankly, care very little about the animals that they steal and subject to appalling instances like that. You know, but we should, I think, in my view, bring all pets under the same protections. All our pets are treated as living, treasured animals, not just property, whether they're cats, whether they're dogs. But the benefits of having a specific offence of pet theft that would offer these protections to all companion animals goes beyond simply recognising the emotional attachment we have to our pets. There are also very practical benefits of doing so. According to the Kennel Club, 98% of dog theft criminals in the UK are never charged, and more than half of cases a suspect is never found. A strong identifier of pet theft would allow cases to be better tracked through the criminal justice system. The UK's Pet Theft Task Force found that consistent and accurate recording of pet thefts would also help identify cases, and the Dogs Trust have highlighted the fact this would build a stronger picture of the true scale of the problem. Proper data collection would also contribute to having more consistency when it comes to punishment, and also proportionate punishments that serve as an effective deterrent. So, Presiding Officer, introducing a criminal offence for pet abduction would be a positive step forward, I believe. It would bring us in line with other parts of the UK and certainly other parts of the world who have already committed to such a move. So I look forward to backing such legislation if Maurice Golden or indeed the government decide to bring that forward. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Finlay Carson. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I congratulate Maurice Golden for securing this debate and bringing this important matter to the Chamber. And I share his concerns about the rapid increase in dog thefts caused by the high demand for dogs during the pandemic and the increase in their value. This is a crime which impacts and upsets nearly 200 affected households across the UK each month, according to the Kennel Club. And in Kilburnie, where I live, two Scottish terriers vanished from their owner's back garden last month, believed to have been snatched. Thankfully, after missing for several days, Archie and Angus were found and returned to their owner. But it shows us an increasing fear of dog theft, and many owners now feel the need to constantly keep an eye on their dog, never leaving them unsupervised. Unsurprisingly so, given that the emotional impacts that owners of stolen dogs can experience are often profound, with many victims reporting depression, diminished social lives, and even on occasion, marriage breakdown as a result. More than a decade ago, I was contacted by a distraught constituent living in Whiting Bay, Arran, after his dog had gone missing. I alerted the police, fearing his colleague Timmy might never be returned. Astonishingly, the dog was located in Staffordshire, having been lifted by an Israeli tourist, ostensibly looking for some canine company whilst touring Britain. And how was he found? Through the microchip, which traced Timmy back to his island owner, who was, of course, absolutely delighted. This important precautionary measure, now a legal requirement, is one that dog owners can take to increase the probability of being reunited with a canine if the worst should happen. But doing so gives dog owners peace of mind and ensures if anyone tries to re-register the dog's chip number, they'll be informed soon after. But as Maurice Golden pointed out, the system is not perfect. Now, a decade ago, inspired by Timmy's recovery, I organised the first free microchipping session in Scotland and Kilburnie, where 167 dogs were chipped, and I followed that up with other such sessions across Cullium North. Soon, microchipping spread throughout much of Scotland, and I can't thank Dogs Trust enough. It was Dogs Trust which not only paid for the microchips, they also funded the staff to install them. Indeed, over many years, Dogs Trust campaigned remorselessly and successfully to introduce compulsory microchipping. And I completely agree with Colin Smith when he says that we should also consider microchipping cats, something that my wife, a Westminster MP, is pursuing, given that she's the chair of the all-party parliamentary group on cats. Unfortunately, 6 years after dog microchipping became a legal requirement in Scotland and across Britain, many dog owners still haven't chipped their dogs. In fact, an English local authority recently said that just 26% of dogs taken in by council dog wardens last year were microchipped with accurate details. The fact that chipping services had to be paused by the SPCA during the pandemic may have further hindered progress. And given the rise of dog theft and the profound impact this crime has on affected owners and pets, I welcome Maurice Golden's motion and his proposed bill to create a specific offence of dog theft. Now, I note recent comments which have already been raised in the Chamber made by Roddy Dunlop QC, Dean of the Faculty of Advocates, who stated there is already a significant deterrent in place in the common law of Scotland and that any court would take the value of the dog to the owner into account when sentencing. This is certainly reassuring, but only up to a point, and we have heard how few cases are actually prosecuted. However, firstly, a separate statutory offence would address the current gap in the available data required to prevent dog thefts and ascertain the true scale of the problem. Secondly, it could act as a deterrent by setting a more realistic maximum sentence, which might actually be used by the courts rather than the current maximum and theoretical sentence for theft of any kind in Scotland, which is life. Thirdly, for philosophical reasons, a statutory offence would differentiate between the theft of an object and a living animal. And it's quite interesting that members keep referring to mobile phones as if that appears to be their most important possession. This would establish a clear difference in the law between objects and sentient animals, thus recognising the welfare impact on the dog, rather than just treating it as a commodity loss for the dog owner. Presiding officer, I'm alarmed by the recent increase in incidents of dog thefts across Scotland, and I therefore welcome that a formal consultation on Mr Golden's proposed bill to introduce a specific statutory crime for dog theft will begin next month. I'm hopeful the introduction of a specific offence will not only recognise the emotional impact and trauma stealing a dog has on owners and pets, it will also act as a strong deterrent to potential offenders, while equally establishing a separate database for dog theft to track the numbers of offences being committed.
Thank you. I now call Finlay Carson to be followed by Stephen Kerr, and Mr Kerr will be the last speaker in the open debate. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Carson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And firstly, can I thank my colleague Maurice Golden for bringing this important debate on tackling dog theft to the Chamber. Sadly, hardly a week passes without a story appearing in a national or local newspaper about a family pet being snatched from a garden, park or even the street. The impact of this often on individual families is devastating, to say the least, which is why I fully support any moves to make dog theft a specific offence that would hopefully reduce theft cases and crucially provide protection to all companion animals and bring those involved in such cruel acts to face tough and quicker justice. We as a Scottish Parliament must send out a clear and concise message that dog theft is no longer or was ever acceptable, nor will it be tolerated in the future. People must be prepared to go down this road will be severely punished for their cowardly actions. Well, we know that dogs are traditionally men and women's best friends, and I've had a dog all my life, and I know the pain of losing a dog through an accident, and a theft would be the same. And I would have spoken a lot about my current dog, but I would get really emotional because the poor old soul's coming at the end of his life, but it's still very much part of the family. And Robert Burns, our national bard, had a beloved collie dog, which he chose to immortalise in the Twa Dogs. But I think he may well have also said that the rights of cats merit some attention. And Colin Smith has catnapped much of my contribution, but I make no apology in highlighting the alarming rate in cat thefts. Once again, this worrying increase impacts not only on their owners, but it has an impact on the cats as well. A pet theft awareness report carried out by Cat Protections revealed cat theft crime has risen by more than 12% on a like-for-like basis in the last year alone, and with a near threefold increase of 194% between 2015 and 2020. Like many of the dogs stolen to order, it's the high-value cat breeds, in particular Bengals, that remain the most targeted cat, with the thieves looking to make a financial killing on the black market. I certainly will.
Maurice Golden.
Just to clarify, I will be consulting on the inclusion of cats and other companion animals, but as Christine Graham highlighted, my focus is ensuring that this Members' Bill is sound and functional, and expanding the scope could be more problematic for me when you consider that the government have a whole civil service to support them, and I've got me and a researcher in a little office in Broughty Ferry, but nonetheless.
Mr Carson?
I absolutely take that on board and sympathise with you for having a small office in Broughty Ferry, but I absolutely take that on board, and my priority also would be to support in your bill to protect dogs. But I'm also told by Cat Protections that for many cats, in fact, they're being stolen for breeding purposes. And there's been a number of instances where cats have actually been returned home with side shaved where there was a scarf or neutering would have been present. And this suggests that thieves are actually targeting cats directly in order to breed from them. And the rise in cat thefts can also be attributed to online marketing cats and kittens, where many owners are increasingly more likely to buy their cat than adopt. But more than a third of cats obtained by individual or families in the last year bought them, and increasingly the public are going online to find that cat, with 68% purchased through this method last year. Analysis of the trend have also revealed that cat prices across three pet-selling websites, which include Gumtree, Preloved and Pets for Home, has rocketed in the last year, with people spending an average of £474 in 2021 compared to £327 the year previous. Of course, This has helped fuel demand and make cat and kitten theft, just like dog theft, far more attractive to thieves looking to profit directly off the sharp rise in prices. Sadly, what is not taken into account, and it should, as far as I'm concerned, is the devastating effect it has on cats and their owners and the families who love them. For many cats and kitten owners, these cute companions provide proved to be a godsend during the pandemic, providing important interaction, friendship and even direction and love during anxious and troubled times. It should also be mentioned that cats are especially prone to stress, which is triggered by changes in their environment or stressful situation, such as being transported. And I share the call from Cats Protection that a specific offence for pet theft covering all companion animals, including cats and dogs, should be introduced, but absolutely take on board Maurice Golding's position when it comes to ensuring the dog theft gets through the legislation. Furthermore, it should include access to appropriate...
Mr Carson, could you please start to conclude?
I will.
You're about 5 minutes now. Thank you,
Deputy Presiding Officer. Finally, I'd like to go back to Colin Smith's discussion on microchipping. That is really important for cats as well. I'm sure that the issues I've highlighted do have significance not only around cats but in dogs. And when Maurice Golding is successful with this bill, perhaps we could look towards the future with an all-inclusive tackling pet theft debate.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I now call Stephen Kerr. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Kerr.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I would like to make a short contribution to support my colleague and friend, Maurice Golding, in his attempts to bring forward this particular piece of legislation, the shape of which is currently being defined through the process he's taking it through. I really look forward to the fact that Scotland taking a lead in this area. I think it's something that we should endeavour to do. Now, the truth be told, Deputy Presiding Officer, we don't have a dog at home. And I often wish we did, because I grew up with dogs. My mum and dad always had a dog. It was always a West Highland Terrier. I'm not sure whether, having listened to your speech, I'm not sure whether I want a particular dog. But each of these West Highland Terriers had its own personality. In fact, to be truthful, I had a bit of a problematic relation with at least one of them, who saw me really as an interloper in the family, and the dog saw itself as the true heir. Dogs do see themselves in this context, of course, and members of families treat them as full and equal members of the family. And there actually came a point in life for my mum and dad when they decided that they reached an age where they weren't going to get another dog. And that's when my dad's health began to become an issue. And my sister had the bright idea that what dad needed was a dog. He'd always had a dog. And so he got a rescue dog, Tara. Now, if anyone has ever loved a dog, my dad loved dogs. And if anyone has ever loved a dog, they will know that the difference a dog can make to a person. And it made a huge difference to my dad and his love of life. And now, this was a dog that had been abused. It was a very nervous dog. But dad's devotion to the dog calmed the poor creature's nerves and nervousness. He walked it several times a day. He pampered it. In return, the dog showed him nothing but devotion. It was a perfect match. Now, the reason I say all this is because I just want to assert one thing in my speech this afternoon, and that is that a dog is not a thing. And that should be accepted. And there should be some statute that reflects that. A dog is a loving companion, a loyal companion. And through walks and eating schedules, diaries are often structured around the needs of a dog. And such a time commitment demonstrates the burgeoning relationship between a dog and its owner. And when a dog is stolen, it's the separation of this loving relationship causes trauma for both sides. For the owner, they're separated from a loving companion who's always been there for them, leaving them with emotions ranging from anger to despair. For the dog, they've been ripped away from their safe home, from loving owners. Who can imagine the feelings of insecurity, vulnerability and loneliness that a dog has? For the sake of the welfare of both the owner and the pet, I think we in the Scottish Parliament can take a lead and treat the issue of dog theft with the seriousness it deserves. Now, worryingly, there's an increasing number of families that are facing this heartbreaking situation. A number of us have referred to in speeches, well-crafted and well-informed speeches, I might add, about the number of dog theft cases in 2020 compared with the previous year. And that's been gone over quite well. So I won't take time to revisit those statistics. But this is not a situation that we should be content to accept in this Parliament. We need to do something about it. We must ensure that owners can remain hopeful of reunion by ensuring that there is some kind of justice. We must ensure that dogs themselves can feel the love and security of their owners and home again. So I thank Maurice Golden for raising the profile of this particular crime and highlighting the need for a specific crime in relation to the theft of dogs. I repeat again, dogs are not objects. They're not even just pets. They are loving members of families across Scotland, and the law should be updated to acknowledge and recognise this fact. Therefore, I support calls for there to be specific legislation on dog theft.
Thank you. And I now call on Minister Ash Regan to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to begin this evening by thanking Maurice Golden for securing the debate on this important subject this evening. And we are a nation of dog lovers, and dogs can be irreplaceable members of the family, as many members this evening have shared stories. I'll just start by saying that I started my day this morning by my dog jumping onto my bed and waking me up by licking my face, which is not my favourite thing, but there we go. Over the last 2 years during the pandemic, dogs and other pets, I know there's been much mention made of cats as well this evening, have provided companionship for many people, and perhaps especially those who were living alone at a time when social contact was limited to prevent the spread of coronavirus. And those with dogs or other pets will find it all too easy to imagine that sense of loss, of anger, of hopelessness that they would feel if their dog were to be stolen. And while I absolutely acknowledge that any theft of a dog is a serious matter, which can cause real anxiety and upset to its owners, I think it is important to note, just for context this evening, that it's not a high-volume crime in Scotland. And last year, the Scottish Government contacted Police Scotland, who confirmed to us that in their internal records, it was showing that there were 62 cases recorded across the whole of Scotland. So that was 2019-20. And that did increase to 88 cases in 2020-21. But that is still a low number when obviously seen in context in a moment against the number of dogs in Scotland. But as other members have noted, this increase we think is likely being driven by the rise in demand for puppies during lockdown that year. I'll give way.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the member for giving way. Does the minister accept that the way in which police record dog theft isn't consistent across the whole of Scotland, and sometimes it's not even recorded as a dog theft, and therefore the numbers associated with that do not necessarily correlate with the true picture on the ground?
Minister.
I would agree with the member that I think there's always ways that we could be looking to improve that data that we have access to, so I would take that point from the member. Police Scotland indicated that while they don't have statistics as yet for 21-22, their impression is that levels of dog theft have since fallen away again and returned back to that previous level that we saw. So, Presiding Officer, there's estimated to be at least 600,000 dogs in Scotland, and so the scale of theft is low within that context, although a traumatic experience it is undoubtedly when it occurs to a loved family pet. As members have noted, dogs are, of course, not objects. And when they're stolen, this can often cause considerable upset. And when a person's pet is lost or stolen, the monetary value of that pet, I think, will be the last thing on that person's mind. So, Presiding Officer, we've seen posters put up by people who've lost their pet dogs or cats offering rewards for their return, many, many times higher than the monetary value that that pet might have, you know, because of the value to the person that pet has to them. So I'm aware that Maurice Golden considers the best way for the justice system to address this particular harm caused by the theft of pets is to create a specific statutory offence. And my understanding is that the member considers this would recognise that the theft of a dog can have a serious effect on its owner. And, Presiding Officer, where a dog or any family pet is stolen, I agree that it is important that the criminal justice system is able to deal effectively with perpetrators of dog theft. And as members will know, and we've discussed this evening, theft is a common law offence in Scotland, and the maximum penalty that can be imposed is limited only by the sentencing powers of the court in which the offender is being sentenced. But I've heard concerns that where an offender is sentenced for theft, the court will be concerned only with the value of the item that has been stolen. But I don't think that that is the case. I think that courts are very well used to taking account of the facts and the circumstances of each individual case. And when sentencing a person for the theft of a dog or pet, the court would take into account the fact that the offender stole a beloved family pet and the impact that this has had. So, Presiding Officer, we will of course consider carefully any bill that is brought forward which proposes a specific offence of dog theft. And one of the key questions is whether this would bring greater transparency to how the justice system responds to this kind of offending and provide reassurance to victims that the impact that this crime has had on them has been taken into account when sentencing the perpetrator. I will.
Jamie Green.
It's not just the level of the sentence. One of the key benefits of specific legislation is the message that it sends to the criminals, is that there is a high tariff associated with this type of crime. Would that not serve as a deterrent, given the rise in cases?
Minister.
Well, I've set the context out. I'm not sure it is right to characterise this as a rise in cases, because as I've set out, we think that the level has returned to pre-pandemic levels. But I would say education and deterrence in general are very important things that we should all take note of. But with any new law, we need a clear evidence base. I'm sure the members would accept what I'm saying about that, to show that it will have a real and beneficial impact. And as members have indicated this evening, I would recognise that a theft of a beloved pet has a particular impact on those from whom the pet has been stolen. That has come out strongly this evening in this debate. And the criminal law policy question is whether the creation of a specific criminal offence meaningfully adds to the police and to courts' powers to tackle dog theft, given the wide-ranging powers the courts already have to take relevant matters into account when sentencing. And, Presiding Officer, today's debate has been good in raising awareness of the important issue of dog theft. And I'd like to begin my conclusion on what hopefully will be considered a positive note. So Police Scotland have advised that their records show that in around half of all cases where a dog is reported as being stolen, the dog is subsequently reunited with its owner. And it's clear that this is much easier to achieve where the dog has been microchipped. And that was a theme that came out this evening strongly as well, that microchipping is an effective method to identify animals to help reunite them with their owners when they are lost or stolen. And as members may be aware, it was this government that made it compulsory for all dogs to be microchipped and for contact details to be kept up to date. And it's standard practice for enforcement agencies to scan all dogs that are coming into their care. And this helps to ensure that when where a lost or stolen dog is recovered, it can be swiftly returned to its owners. So, Presiding Officer, the Government is happy to work with interested parties, including the police and animal welfare organisations, to look at what can be done to improve how pet theft is addressed in our criminal justice system, and happy to consider any specific new evidence-based proposals on how the criminal law could be improved in this area.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.